Hello and welcome guys. We are here with the latest NEET-PG 2020 medicine paper and with the explanation of the paper. So first of all, congratulations to all the students. Your hard work of 1 year ultimately has come to an end, and we wish you best of luck for your results. We also congratulate you for the patience and the perseverance that you have shown for the whole year. We are coming up guys with this explanation. The MCQs here are basically all memory based that we have got from our students as feedback. So the MCQs, you will find sometimes the options are missing, one or the other options are missing. We have tried our level best to get the best possible MCQs that are there for the medicine. So we will start with the discussion on the MCQ. And one thing that is to be noted guys, that the paper was a bit tough, or you can say there were mixed reactions that came up. The questions were lengthy, the questions were more of clinical based, the questions were more of inclined towards emergency medicine. So what we are trying to do here guys is that in this section we will discuss those MCQs that have come from the memory base of the students. So let us start with the first MCQ. Traditional MCQ that always gets asked, the risk factors for coronary artery disease. They have asked about the metabolic syndrome criteria, include all of the following except. So hypertension is there, central obesity is there, hypertriglyceridemia is there. So one option that is ruled out is a high LDL. So as we see that elevated or obesity is one of the important risk factor, where you have the waist circumference getting increased, you have the elevated triglycerides, you have reduced LDL, then you have the elevated blood pressure, and you have the elevated fasting glucose. So this is one of the traditional very easy MCQ that came up. But certain important discussion that needs to be done is the emerging and the latest risk factors that are getting asked as far as the coronary artery disease is concerned. So first and foremost guys, important risk factor is the C-reactive protein. So we do a C-reactive protein. It's a strong and independent risk factor. It's a strong and an independent risk factor of coronary artery disease. And this risk factor is not just the risk factor for coronary artery disease guys, but it can all, it's also a predictor of the stroke. It's a predictor of peripheral arterial disease as well as sudden cardiac death. Why these MCQs are important guys, and why some of the important discussions that we are doing here is that always we will see in the coming discussion that there are certain questions that get asked in AIIMS, then the topic gets repeated or a similar topic gets repeated or enhanced in the further exams. So it's very important to understand and pay attention to the topics that are getting asked in this, because they might get asked in the future, that is May AIIMS to 2020 exam. So it is a important risk factor, but a better predictor. It's a better predictor. It's a better predictor of cardiovascular risk than the other predictors, that is lipoprotein A. Again, will be a very important topic that requires enhancement. Then you have hyperhomocysteine. And interleukin 6. These are the three important predictors, but out of them the C-reactive protein is a very important predictor. It's a high risk when this is elevated. Elevated HS C-reactive protein guys, it's a high risk factor for future cardiovascular event. High risk factor for future cardiovascular event. It's a predictor of a bad event in the immediate future. What are the guidelines? The guidelines of HSC reactive protein are mild, low risk, moderate risk, and the high risk. So when it is less than 1 mg/L, less than 1 to 3 mg/L, and you have greater than 3 mg/L. These are important values. When it is less than 1 mg/L, it shows a low risk of a future event, future cardiovascular event, moderate risk 1 to 3, and the third one is a high risk. So guys, we have to also, you have to keep in mind and remember these values as well. Maybe in the future questions, they might just put the value and ask you about whether it's a high risk or high probability that is to be answered. The second important predictor is hyperhomocysteine. Hyperhomocysteine levels, they are a strong correlation with, they have a strong positive correlation with atherosclerosis. And the coronary thrombotic event. Coronary thrombotic event. Then the last one, guys, that we'll look into is lipoprotein A. Lipoprotein A. This is not lipoprotein B, guys. This is lipoprotein A. It has a structural homology to plasminogen. Structural homology to plasminogen. Plasminogen then increase lipoprotein A levels has a moderate risk. Has a moderate risk. So it's a predictor of a moderate risk factor that is there. This next question is a very, very simple, guys. Very simple question. All are found in left ventricular failure. The except that is you have the lung oligemia, Kerley B lines, rails, and pedal edema. Obviously, whenever there will be a left ventricular failure, there will be a back pressure into the lungs. So this is your left side of the heart. Is as simple as that. When this chamber fails, obviously the blood is going to go into the lungs. So whenever left ventricle has failed, there will be a back pressure into the lung, and this will not lead to a lung oligemia. So this is the answer. It will lead to pulmonary congestion, the Kerley lines, the bilateral rails, which will be followed by pulmonary, maybe pulmonary increased pulmonary pressure, right-sided pressure, and ultimately may lead to pedal edema. So this was a quite simple question. Next question was, what are hammer pulse is seen in? So this is a very, again, a very easy and a traditional question that get asked. So what are hammer pulse is an important pulse that you see in aortic regurgitation. So answer is aortic regurgitation. And what are hammer pulse is a sign of wide pulse pressure. Wide pulse pressure. So there was a Chinese toy. You have this water hammer pulse seen in all the cases of wide pulse pressure. But apart from the wide pulse, what are the other signs of wide pulse pressure? Number one, you have what is called as a Corrigan sign. Corrigan's sign. What is this Corrigan sign? As a result of increased pressure, what do you see? You can just see this GIF, guys, that you can see the carotid pulsations over here. Corrigan sign is also called as dancing carotids. Dancing carotid sign. Apart from these signs, there are other signs as well. So The other signs of the wide pulse pressure, they are the demusset sign, that is nodding of the head that is seen, the demusset sign. Then you have the Müller sign, where the pulsations of the uvula, they become visible. Then you have one more important sign that is called as the, so you have the Corrigan sign, you have the demusset signs, and then you have the Quinque sign. So what is a Quinque sign? It is capillary pulsations that are visible at the nail bed. Capillary pulsation at nail bed. It is called as the Quinque's sign. So here you can see this image. They can also put a small GIF, guys. So you can see that the pulsations will be very clearly visible over here, called as the Quinque's sign. Then you have the next sign called as the Durozy's murmur or Durozy's sign. Durozy's sign or a Durozy's murmur. What is it? It's a femoral retrograde bruit or a femoral retrograde murmur. Femoral retrograde bruit or a murmur. You have to remember, guys, it's this murmur is basically a diastolic. Or the sound is a diastolic sound. Then the next is the Traub sign. What is Traub sign? Traub sign also called as pistol shot sounds at the femoral. Pistol shot sound at femoral. When you put the stetho, you hear as if somebody is shooting a pistol, called as the Traub's sign. Then you have the next, that is the Hill sign. So what is Hill sign? Hill sign is low extremity pressure, that is blood pressure in the lower extremity. Lower extremity is greater than the BP in the upper arm. Lower than the upper arm. So depending upon how much it is lower or how much it is higher, we have to know these values as well, guys. So if it is greater than 20 mm of Hg, greater than 20 mm of Hg, we say that this is a mild AR. Mild aortic regurgitation. If it is greater than 40 mm of Hg, we say it's a moderate AR. If it is greater than 60 mm of Hg, it is a severe AR. So these are very, very important stuff, guys. Remember this, also make it a star mark, because generally these topics along with the pressure changes are not covered anywhere else. So make sure that you read it. It's very important to understand that these are some of the very important stuff that can get asked in the future. Plus there are three very important signs that are there. Number one is called as Becker's sign. Becker's sign. So what is Becker's sign, guys? It is visible pulsations in the retinal artery. Visible pulsations in retinal arteries and pupils. And pupils. Then next one is Meynie's sign. Meynie's sign. What is a Meynie's sign? It is basically greater than 15 millimeters of mercury pressure greater than 50 mmHg, drop in the blood pressure with arm elevated. With arm elevated from value obtained. From value obtained. With arm in the standard position. Arm in standard position. Standard position called as the mini sign. Then you have one more important sign called as Rosenbach sign. You have the Rosenbach sign. What is Rosenbach sign, guys? It is systolic pulsations of the liver. Systolic liver pulsations. Rosenbach sign. The last one is Gerhard sign. Gerhard's sign. So what is a Gerhard sign? It is systolic pulsations of the spleen. Systolic pulsation of spleen called as the Gerhard sign. So all these very important four signs, guys, that is the Becker sign, Meini sign, Rosenbach sign and the Gerhard sign. These are all the new signs that I have discussed with you. You not find it in general any of the books or anywhere getting discussed. These are very, very important stuff for the future MCQs. Suddenly they might appear in one or the other of the exam and then there is elaboration of the topic. So guys, read them nicely. They are very, very important stuff for your future, maybe AIIMS and the next All India. It's a very, very important predictor MCQ. Then the next MCQ is, there are two MCQs. We will discuss off the MCQs first and then we'll go on with the discussion. So number one is loss of pain and temperature sensation on the ipsilateral face and contralateral body due to thrombosis in. This is thrombosis due to which artery? It's very simple, guys. They are talking about loss of pain and temperature sensation on the ipsilateral and ipsilateral face and the contralateral body. That is contralateral pain and temperature are getting lost. So the answer here, this is basically, guys, a important syndrome, that is lateral medullary syndrome, or what we call as the Wallenberg syndrome. The answer is PICA, or the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Then the next question they have asked is ataxia dysdidecokinesia artery involved is. So it's very simple. This is also a posterior cerebral artery symptoms that are there. So we'll just evaluate one by one the important options that are there. Number one, in the first MCQ, what they are discussing or what they have put is that the patient is having a ipsilateral loss of, the patient is having a ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature loss and contralateral also. They say that there is loss of pain and temperature. So you can say contralateral also there is loss of spinothalamic. So loss of ipsilateral pain and temperature is obviously the answer will be a lateral medullary syndrome. Also called as the Wallenberg syndrome. Wallenberg syndrome. So they ask you, guys, which is the most common artery for this? Most common artery. to get involved. So most common artery, guys, is the vertebral artery. Remember, vertebral artery. As vertebral artery is not in the option, the second most common artery to be involved is the pica, posterior inferior cerebral artery. So this is an important question, guys, and whenever these type of questions they are getting asked, we have to put into or go into some important basics, that instead of sensory, if the question would have been a motor loss, what would have been the answer? That is ipsilateral face, that is motor loss, and a contralateral hemiplegia. So here in this case, guys, the answer would have been a Millard-Gubler or a pontine syndrome. Pontine stroke. So artery of distribution is very, very important, guys, and we have to understand whenever they are giving you a ipsilateral sensory or a ipsilateral or contralateral hemiplegia, hemisensory or a hemianesthesia loss, it is very important to have those important shortcut, guys, because these syndromes are very big. Maybe they might sometimes give you 2-3 liner or a 4-5 liner big question. You have a small digital screen in front of you, and in a limited time you have to solve the question. So for that, you need to have those shortcuts and important hints that you need to pick up from the question. Set up that jigsaw puzzle so that you get to the answer very quickly. So if generally we are given the case of a hemiplegia, but if in the question they ask you and change the scenario to maybe a contralateral hemisensory loss, so instead of a motor there is a contralateral hemisensory loss, so what will be the answer? Either the answer will be a middle cerebral artery or the cortical branches, or it will be a posterior cerebral artery, that is what you call as the medullary syndrome, or the artery generally is the vertebral artery, or you can say the pica. How do you get into it? You get into this medullary syndromes or these syndromes when you have an additional hint in the question. So what is that additional hint? They will add up cranial nerves to the discussion. So if there is involvement along with the sensory, if they give you involvement of the cranial nerve, they give you one or the other cranial nerve, that means either it's a midbrain syndrome or a pontine syndrome or a medullary syndrome. So generally the midbrain, pontine and the medullary generally will be coming with the motor loss. Importantly, the medullary syndrome, it comes with the sensory loss. So always remember, guys, whenever with any kind of a loss, whether it's a sensory loss or whether it's a motor loss, a hemisensory or a hemiplegia, they are given in the question. If they are adding up cranial nerves, that means they are asking you about the brainstem syndromes. If they are not adding up the cranial nerves, that means they are asking you about the somatosensory cortex or the lower down tracts that are generally lying into the territory of the middle cerebral artery. So this is very, very important hint that needs to be understood while answering these important questions. And the next question that relates to it is, guys, the two questions that are there. We'll see those two questions. They are important questions. Number one, frontal gyrus lesion will lead to, obviously they are on aphasias, so they lead to Broca's aphasia. The second question is superior temporal gyrus, the lesion will be it will be a Wernicke's aphasia. So in this question, what they have done is they have asked you about both the types of aphasia. So we will just see the way in which the central nervous system is organized, and in short, how to come to the different diagnosis and what are the different types of aphasia. So this area over here, this is the Wernicke's area, guys. This area over here is the Broca's area. Then connecting these two areas is a bundle that we call as the arcuate fasciculus. Arcuate fasciculus. At the moment, these are the three most important areas that we have to remember, but along with that you have some accessory area also. These are called as, or this is called as, transcortical motor, and an accessory area over here that is called as transcortical sensory. So it's very important to note the different types of aphasias that are there and the MCQs that get asked to edit. So we'll just make a table and we'll try and understand. The different types of aphasias, we'll deal with three important characteristics. Number one, fluency. Number two is comprehension. And number three is repetition. Depending upon these three important characteristics in the question, you will have to come to the diagnosis. So obviously the first one, where you have a loss of fluency, loss of repetition, but the comprehension is preserved. This is basically a shortage of the motor one. This is Broca's aphasia. Or what you call as the motor aphasia. The second one is where you have fluency is being preserved, guys, but the comprehension is lost, repetition is lost. This is Wernicke's aphasia. The third one is where you have the problem of, number one, fluency is also preserved, comprehension is also preserved, but repetition is getting hampered, guys. So what is happening over here is that, number one, this area is functioning properly. Comprehension means this Wernicke's area is also functioning properly. But what is happening is that the repetition of the word is getting hampered. So this is what we call as the conduction aphasia. It is because of the conduction aphasia, and this conduction aphasia occurs as a result of damage to the arcuate fasciculus that is connecting the third, all the three. The next or the last one is where everything is gone. You have fluency is gone, repetition is gone, comprehension is gone. This is a global aphasia. It's important to remember they are asking the arteries also at the moment, so we need to remember the arteries as well as the areas that are involved. So number one, in Broca's area, it is the middle cerebral artery, or MCA, that is the superior division of the middle cerebral artery. Wernicke is again MCA, but it is the inferior division. Conduction aphasia, the problem lies in the arcuate fasciculus. Again, the damage is at the middle cerebral artery. And obviously the area, where do they lie? The area that is Broca's area, it lies at the inferior frontal gyrus. inferior frontal gyrus. Wernicke's, it lies at the superior temporal gyrus. Superior temporal gyrus and the arcuate fasciculus that we have already seen. But here, to sum up all these important questions, guys, that is the two on the aphasias and the central nervous system, that is these two on the Wallenberg syndrome. We will sum up this discussion with a important discussion on how to form that jigsaw puzzle and how to come to that diagnosis and how to come to the artery of distribution. So number one, we have the circle of Willis. It's a representative diagram, guys, that I am drawing. And this circle of Willis is formed by different blood vessels. So here are the vertebral arteries. Vertebral artery. Here is the basilar. Here is the basilar artery. Vertebral artery, basilar artery, and then the main three. So what are the main three? You have the anterior cerebral artery, you have the middle cerebral artery, and you have the posterior cerebral artery. So you have the anterior cerebral artery, anterior cerebral artery, the middle cerebral artery, and the posterior cerebral artery, guys. So what are the important hints that are there in the question to solve the questions pretty quickly? So remember these hints nicely. Whenever you have the anterior cerebral artery, there will be loss of or motor loss that will be more at the feet and legs will suffer more of a motor loss. Second important hint that will be there in the question is cognitive behavior is impaired, cognition and behavior impaired. Number two, reappearance of the third is primitive reflexes. Primitive reflexes will reappear. If you have any of the three, mainly this is a anterior cerebral artery stroke. Middle cerebral artery, you will have a contralateral loss. You will have a contralateral loss of upper limb and the face region. This is a motor loss. This is this face region that is there, guys. This is a contralateral face and not an ipsilateral face. This is because of the motor area that is there in the, or primary motor cortex that is there on the cerebral cortex, guys. And this is not because of the seventh cranial nerve facial palsy. Whenever you have in the brainstem syndromes, it will be a ipsilateral seventh cranial nerve. So here it's a contralateral phase. This is very, very important to understand, guys. The second one is the aphasias will be there. So they will give you a hint in terms of aphasias. The third important hint in the question will be a contralateral sensory loss. Contralateral sensory loss. How does this differentiate from the medullary syndrome, guys? In the medullary syndrome that we have seen just now, what we had was basically a ipsilateral face sensory is gone and a contralateral sensory, that is spinothalamic, is gone. Ipsilateral face, contralateral spinothalamic. In terms of cortex, what we have in terms of cortex of middle cerebral artery, most important hint, guys, it will be a contralateral face and a contralateral sensory. Whenever you have both, the answer will be a cortical, middle cerebral artery will be the answer of choice. Then obviously you have the posterior cerebral artery, and this generally will present with vertebrobasilar. Vertebrobasilar involvement. So either it will be in the form of pontine or medullary midbrain syndrome. Midbrain syndrome. So it all depends on the different types of cranial nerves that are associated with these areas. So different cranial nerves at different places. You go and watch our section on neurology and brainstem syndromes. We have dealt with it in great detail there, guys. So this was about these questions. Next question was broad base gait plus aneurysis. The answer was normal pressure hydrocephalus. This presents, guys, with a triad. And what is the triad or normal pressure hydrocephalus? Number one, there will be dementia. So you have dementia along with you have gait abnormality. Gait abnormality, and lastly you have urinary urgency or incontinence. Urgency or incontinence. Or incontinence. What happens? The dementia is more for executive impairment. Executive impairment is more permanent. Is more prominent. Gait abnormality will present as ataxia or apraxia. Ataxia or apraxia. Then what is this normal pressure hydrocephalus? On the imaging, guys, it shows a typical feature. So this is the imaging that we have. And on imaging, what does it show? It shows enlarged lateral ventricle. Enlarged lateral ventricle. Enlarged lateral ventricle along with no cortical atrophy. This is very, very important, guys. No cortical atrophy. And this is what we call as, or this appearance is what we call as box carrying, box cutting. What we call as box cutting. Then this type of a normal pressure hydrocephalus, this is a communicating hydrocephalus, guys. Communicating hydrocephalus, that means it has a patent aqueduct. It has a patent aqueduct. How do you diagnose or how do you manage? You can do lumbar puncture and remove 30 to 50 cc of CSF. And this will show improvement in gait and cognition transiently. Improves gait and cognition transiently. And finally, how do you manage or treat these patients? You treat with a ventricular shunting. Ventricular shunting. And when you are doing the ventricular shunting, you have improvement of the gait. And along with that, cognition also improves. Cognition also improve, but the gait impairment is more than the cognitive impairment, guys. Next, coming to a very, very important topic, that is again here also the questions have been asked in tandem, guys. So the first and foremost question that is there in this section is in comparison to a normal healthy person in the evening time, which of these will have an elevated ACTH as well as elevated cortisol? So you have an elevated ACTH and an elevated cortisol. So what is the answer? Number one, normal healthy adult individual, Addison disease. Obviously Addison will be, this will be ruled out. Addison is basically a adrenal insufficiency, it gets ruled out. So answer is basically a Cushing's syndrome, guys. So it's important to understand how we evaluate the Cushing's syndrome, because the Cushing's syndrome will be presenting with obviously high cortisol. So you have excess of cortisol or high cortisol, and you do some very important tests for the high cortisol. We have to remember one very, very important mnemonic, guys, that is low than high. Low than high. It's very important to understand low than high. So first off, you are having high cortisol. So the first test that you give to these patients is a low dose dexamethasone suppression. So you have given the low dose dexamethasone suppression. You give a low dose dexamethasone suppression. Obviously the test will either suppress or it will fail to suppress. So if there is no suppression, that means this is basically a Cushing's. Then Cushing's can be because of different causes, guys. We have to evaluate those causes. So for after that, we do a very, very important test. We go for ACTH evaluation. So when you are going for ACTH evaluation, either the ACTH will be high or the ACTH will be low, guys. We'll not go into the details of the different types of or values of ACTH. If ACTH is low, that means this is basically a problem lies in the adrenal. High amount of cortisol is coming from the adrenal, and the cause is basically either a tumor or a hyperplasia. Tumor or a hyperplasia. And investigation of choice, guys, is a CT abdomen. So on a low ACTH level in a patient of Cushing's, this will be, the cause will lie in the adrenal. If this is a high ACTH level, we go for next test, that is high dose dexa suppression. So remember, guys, we started with low then high. It's very important to understand. So either it will suppress or it will not suppress, no suppression. It will be no suppression. It is suppressing. That means the cause is, it is something which is coming from the normal HPA axis. That is why with a high dose you have the suppression. So this most commonly is a tumor that is there in the pituitary, that is called as Cushing's disease. It is a Cushing's disease. If it is not suppressing, that means this high cortisol that is coming, it is not coming from the ACTH that is high, that is leading to a high cortisol, and this ACTH is not coming from the pituitary or the normal HPA axis, hence it is not getting suppressed. That means this is coming from an ectopic source. So what are the important ectopic source, or what you call as paraneoplastic. So what are the important sources? Oat cell carcinoma or small cell cancer, carcinoid, pancreatic malignancy, and you have the bronchial adenoma. Obviously, we have to confirm that this high ACTH that is coming, This is coming from the pituitary. So we need to do one more test that is called as the gold standard. So gold standard for the diagnosis is you do directly take the venous sample from the inferior petrosal vein and just see the levels of ACTH. So if they are high, this is coming from a tumor in the pituitary. So inferior petrosal venous sampling. Petrosal sampling. So this is what is about the important MCQ on the adrenal. Next, to end our discussion on the adrenal, we have to understand one very important thing regarding the adrenal. So you might be given different options. So these different options can bring you up to a different answer. So number one, either they will give you a high cortisol along with a high ACTH. This is one scenario. Number two is a high cortisol along with a low ACTH. Second scenario. So in the first scenario where both are elevated, so either it's because of ACTH producing pituitary adenoma, that is Cushing's disease. Or it can be an ectopic ACTH, where the ACTH is high along with the cortisol getting high. Cortisol is high but ACTH is low. That means it's an adrenal adenoma. Or adrenal carcinoma. Or it's a exogenous steroid. So this is how are the permutation and the combinations that are to be remembered as far as the high steroid is concerned. Then we have two important MCQs. We will discuss the MCQs first and then we will go on and look into the answer. They both of them deal with adrenal insufficiency. Question number one is patient undergoes bilateral adrenalectomy for a bilateral pheochromocytoma and on day one, the patient is developing lethargy, fatigue. The two very important hints in this question is he is having a normal BP, his pulse is normal and there is no evidence of water loss, guys. That means a hypovolemic shock, cardiogenic shock, or the shocks are ruled out. The answer is primarily a cortisol deficiency. Similar question, not seen in ACTH deficiency. So you see all of these, you see nausea, fatigue, you see hyperpigmentation. This is very, very important, guys. So you have hyperpigmentation, you have the ACTH deficiency and you have anorexia. So out of these, which of the following is not seen? You don't see hyperpigmentation. So hyperpigmentation is the answer. But we'll just go into the adrenal insufficiency and look what kind of an important feature it is there. So here, guys, in this question, we have to understand that number one, that there are two types of adrenal insufficiency. Number one is what you call as primary adrenal insufficiency. Primary adrenal insufficiency where the problem lies in the adrenal. And the second one is what you call as the secondary adrenal insufficiency. Secondary adrenal insufficiency. So it is very important to understand, guys, that in primary and the primary adrenal insufficiency, the problem lies in the adrenal gland. Secondary adrenal insufficiency, the problem lies in the HPA axis. Now what is there in the question? In this adrenal gland, where the problem lies in the adrenal gland, obviously there will be a high ACTH. There's a high ACTH. Insufficiency is there, low cortisol is there, primary problem in the adrenal. It gives a feedback of low cortisol to the pituitary. Pituitary starts secreting more ACTH, so ACTH is high and the patient has hyperpigmentation. Number two, problem lies in the HPA axis. So the pituitary is abnormal. So what will happen in this case? There will be a low ACTH, because the problem is in the pituitary, and this low ACTH is unable to stimulate the adrenal glands, which are unable to release the important cortisol. And in this case, you get what is called as paleness or alabaster pale skin. That is why what was asked, guys, not seen in ACTH deficiency. That means ACTH is here low, guys. This was asked. ACTH is low. That is ACTH deficiency and not hyper ACTH. That is why you don't find hyperpigmentation over there, but you find a alabaster paleness that is there in the skin. Then coming to the next question, guys, the next question again deals with the pituitary. There are these two questions. In the first question, it was asked, a female after delivery develops features of nausea, visual complaints, fatigue. The syndrome is suggestive of. So answer was Sheehan syndrome. It's a pretty straightforward question that was there. Following is not seen in pituitary apoplexy. So what is not seen in pituitary apoplexy, guys? Hypertension is not seen in pituitary apoplexy. You see headache, you see hypotension, and you see vomiting. So what is pituitary apoplexy? So this is basically panhypopituitarism. It's a panhypopituitarism. Because of hemorrhage. Or infarct in pituitary gland. To be more specific, in the pituitary adenoma. So this is called as pituitary apoplexy. And which type of a pituitary adenoma? Most commonly, this is seen with a somatotrope or a corticotrope. What are the important clinical features that are associated with pituitary apoplexy, guys? There will be severe hypoglycemia. So they might ask you next, maybe this option may be put there. Hypotension is there in the option. Then severe headache. Then you have bilateral visual changes. Ophthalmoplegia. And even the patient can die. So all these are important clinical features that are associated with pituitary apoplexy. Obviously, there will be vomiting, nausea that is associated, but hypertension is not associated, guys. So what are the causes? A pre-existing adenoma is the most common cause, but along with that, there are other causes also. There are different differential diagnoses for this panhypopituitarism. So it's a existing adenoma, or it can be a postpartum. And this postpartum is what is called as Sheehan syndrome. But it can also be as a result of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, sickle cell anemia, acute shock. Most importantly, it can also arise as a result of complication of carotid angiography, guys. Carotid angiography. Then you have the bleeding disorders. Then you have anticoagulation. The anticoagulation therapy. All these are important causes of the panhypopituitarism, or what you call as the pituitary apoplexy. One more important differential diagnosis is there, guys, that we should also know. One is empty cella syndrome. So what is an empty cella syndrome, guys? Empty cella syndrome is an incidental finding. It's a MRI finding. And incidental. Patient is asymptomatic. Generally, the patient is asymptomatic, and usually it arises with a normal pituitary function, where a rim of tissue, is basically functioning and releasing the important hormones that are there. The cella, when you look, it will be an empty cella. Empty cella which is filled by CSF, which contains CSF. And the patient will develop slowly the signs of hypopituitarism. One more important option, or one more important question that can get asked in this scenario of panhypopituitarism, guys, is that which hormone is spared? All the hormones are lost, but which hormone is spared? Which hormone is spared in panhypopituitarism? Obviously, vasopressin, guys. Vasopressin or ADH. It's a posterior pituitary hormone, and this posterior pituitary hormone is basically secreted in the hypothalamus. So even if the pituitary is gone, even if the pituitary is not there, what remains is that the neuronal ends in the hypothalamus will be secreting the vasopressin. Then the next question is very, very simple question that came up, guys. The involvement of the different kinds of joints. So you have DIP, PIP, and the first carpometacarpal joint is getting involved, and the metacarpophalangeal and the wrist are being spared. What is the answer? Answer is straightforward. It's a osteoarthritis. Remember, there are different permutation combinations of this question that come up, guys. So you have DIP plus PIP. When this is involved, The answer is simple, it's osteoarthritis. If PIP plus metacarpophalangeal joint is getting involved, the answer is a RA or a rheumatoid arthritis. There are some specific things that will be given along with these joints. Two very important joints will be given in RA, that is wrist, and number one is the mandible. So the two important hints will be wrist and the mandibular joint, guys. Apart from the osteoarthritis, we should know what are the joints that are spared by osteoarthritis. So metacarpophalangeal joint is spared in osteoarthritis, important hint, and DIP is spared in RA. DIP is spared in RA, a pretty straightforward question, guys. Next, a female patient presents with pain and swelling in the multiple peripheral small joints. Deformity shown below. So this was an image based MCQ where they put up a very straightforward deformity. This was a deformity what is called as swan neck deformity. Answer was rheumatoid arthritis, guys. So you have Boutonnais deformity, you have the Z deformity, you have the swan neck deformity. All are important deformities, pretty very common questions that are getting asked on this topic. Then you have the next question, the first line of drug for postmenopausal osteoporosis. The answer is very straightforward, guys. Bisphosphonates are the drug of choice. So they are drug of choice, they are overall drug of choice, overall drug of choice, and they act by the mechanism of inhibition of osteoclast. They inhibit osteoclast. You have to remember that in this connective tissue question, guys, a same similar question was asked in May AIIMS 2019, guys. And what they asked, what will be the age to do a DEXA scan in a female or to do a bone mineral density? And at that time, the answer was the ideal age is 65 years in female. 65 years in a female. Then one more question is asked, similar question to this was also asked. They have put an image. That is on a visual image based question was there, guys, and the image was of a cod fish vertebra. The answer is pretty straightforward. Again, it's basically a osteoarthritis. So this is a repeat question from last year NEET, guys. It's a plain repeat, simple repeat question from last year 2019 NEET-PG. They have given the DD of the image of a codfish vertebra. So it's very important to understand, guys, that the questions are linked from one exam to the other. So you have to advance the knowledge on some of the important topics. Then the next question was, clinical features of scleroderma is there. Then you have the patient is having acute onset respiratory distress. X-ray shows reticular basilar shadows. What will be the next line of management? So the patient is, the next line of management will be an HRCT, guys. It's a plain simple important test that is to be done, but here the acute onset of respiratory distress, X-ray shows reticular bilateral shadows that are there. The answer of choice will be a HRCT. Then nosocomial infection. What is nosocomial infection is called after how many hours of hospital admission? Again, here the answer is very straightforward. The definition is of 48 hours, guys. Then the next question was, most common opportunistic infection after renal transplant. So this is, you can also say, a solid organ transplant. So most common opportunistic infection is a cytomegalovirus infection. So you have less than 1 month and you have 1 month to 6 months. Cytomegalovirus is amongst the most common infection to be found. Then This again is an important question regarding management of the high altitude reaction or high altitude sickness. They have asked all of the things are done except one thing. So what do? You don't give IV digoxin. You give acetazolamide, you go for a descent. And what will be the management strategy for the high altitude sickness? So acute mountain sickness of the mild nature. Acute mountain sickness of the mild nature. How do you manage? Number one, stop ascent. Number two, acetazolamide. And number three, guys, will be a descent. These are the three important things that you do for a milder case. The drug, the dosage is 250 milligram QID of a acetazolamide. Second is moderate. You have a moderate acute mountain sickness. In this, you go for an immediate descent. You go for a low flow O2. For a low flow oxygen therapy, then you go for acetazolamide, or alternatively you can also use dexa. And finally, if descent is not possible, then you go for hyperbaric therapy. Hyperbaric therapy if descent not possible. If descent is not possible. The third is high altitude cerebral edema. High altitude cerebral edema. So how do you manage these patients? Obviously, you go for an immediate descent. You will give O2 to the patient. The important drug that you give is a dexamethasone. So you give a loading dose of 8 milligram. Either you give it perorally or intramuscularly, or you can also go for IV, which is then followed by a 4 milligram dose. Then if descent is not possible, then you again go for a hyperbaric therapy. That is an important thing about the high altitude cerebral edema. You are not using acetazolamide in this case. The last is high altitude pulmonary edema. High altitude pulmonary edema. So what are the important drugs that you use here? Again, you go for immediate descent. You will give O2 to the patient. You will give the drug of choice over here, guys, is nifedipine. You give nifedipine to the patient. And if descent is not possible, again you go for a hyperbaric therapy. What are the alternate drugs? Alternate drugs that can be given along with nifedipine, you have salmeterol. You have tadalafil. And you have dexa. These are the alternate drugs that can be used, but the drug of choice is nifedipine. The next question that was asked, frostbite patient is rewarmed at which temperature? So answer is basically the patient is warmed at 37 to 40 degrees, guys. So it is always it's a range. That is 37 degrees to 40 degrees. So the best answer will be answer A, that is 37 degrees. How do you manage these patients? Number one, you have to rapidly warm. You have to rapidly warm the patient. How do you do this rapid warming? By immersing in circulating water. Immersing in circulating water and at a temperature of 37 to 40 degree centigrades for a period of, this is also very important, this was not asked in the question, maybe next time they might just do a small improvisation and may ask you the timing, that is 30 to 60 minutes. Second important management strategy apart from the rapid warming is, rapid rewarming is very painful, guys. So you go for parenteral narcotics. Parenteral narcotics can be given, and this can be because of the painful rewarming, and it is given in deep frostbite. The last is, which can help the patient, is prostacycline analogs. Prostacycline analogs can also help, it should be given within 24 hours. Given within, if they are given within 24 hours, this will be useful. This will be useful. So these are the three important management strategies for the frostbite patient. And then you have the next question, a known case of COPD with acute exacerbation of COPD. On examination, patient is conscious, alert, pulses. The patient is having tachycardia. On examination, there is bilateral wheeze. Which of the following is not true, guys? So in this case, what is not true is non-invasive ventilation is not indicated. This is not true, guys. Number one, how do you manage the acute exacerbation of COPD? Number one, you give bronchodilators. You give bronchodilators are given. Either you give salbutamol or you give muscarine antagonist, that is ipratropium. Number two, you give antibiotics. You give antibiotics. Number three, you give a low flow O2. You give a low flow O2. Oxygen therapy is also given. And finally, you go for a non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. And this is to be given if the patient is having a PaCO2 level of greater than 45 mm of Hg. If this is there, you go for a non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. Depending upon the need, you also go with the invasive, that is endo, you put the endotracheal tube and you go for the invasive procedure as well. But one very, very important thing, the option that may have confused the students, or there were many students who asked that permissible hypercapnia, how was this a correct answer? Guys, we have to remember that the patients of COPD, there will be increased amount of CO2 trapping that is there. So because of this increased amount of CO2 trapping that is there, and this is a chronic disease going on for a very long period of time. So what happens in this, guys, that the respiratory center gets acquainted to this high CO2 that is there in the blood. Later on, over a long period of time, the respiratory drive, it shifts from the CO2 mediated to the O2 mediated drive. That is why whenever we are giving, we give a low flow O2. We don't give a high flow O2, and you permit some amount of hypercapnia that is there. You want some amount of high CO2 to be there. If that is not there, you give a high flow O2. You remove too much of carbon dioxide, suddenly the patient will have, the respiratory center will sense it, and there will be a stoppage of the respiratory center, and the patient can go into a respiratory failure. That is why you permit some amount of hypercapnia. Along with that, you give a low flow oxygen therapy. So these were the important questions. These are the memory based questions that got asked in the NEET-PG 2020. We have tried to give you the best out of the lot. We couldn't get all the 30 because some questions were very lengthy. Somewhere on the intensive care management or critical care medicine. So they were all memory based. Over a period of time, those MCQs will also come up. But whatever we could get from the memory based questions, the most authentic, we have arranged and we have come up with the answers. Plus, we have also come up with some of the important things that might be asked in the future exams, especially in the May AIIMS, guys. So best of luck for your preparation. Do go and check out our app for medicine. It's very important. The topics will be dealt with in detail over there. So thank you very much and best of luck for your preparation.